Welcome to another edition of Saturday Sit Down. This week, we go below the border, down to the United States, Minnesota, where we find former Lethbridge Hurricane and now Minnesota Wild defenseman Brennan Menell. And Brennan, how are things going for you of late? We'll get to the NHL bubble experience shortly, but how are things overall for you and the family?
It's going good. Yeah, like you said, I'm in Minnesota for the summer. That's where I grew up, and I spend my summers there. So right now, just finishing up the season. I've been hanging out and enjoying the lakes and the nice weather. So it's been nice.
I want to talk about your time in Lethbridge that one year, an unforgettable year as well, a little bit later on. But let's touch on the most recent history for you. Last week, as we record this, the week prior, you were in Edmonton, part of the Minnesota Wild roster for the play-in series against the Vancouver Canucks. Talk about what that whole experience was like being in the NHL bubble, and take us into it.
Yeah, you know, it was an experience that you didn't really know what to expect. No one did. It was something unlike, you know, anyone's ever done before. So, but, you know, it exceeded my expectations, and we were treated so well, and, you know, we came in, and Edmonton was a great city to host it. Coming in and just being able to get back to playing and get back to playoff hockey, it was, you know, it was great, and got to spend more time with my teammates, and, you know, I was very happily surprised.
Yeah, from all accounts, everything that we've seen on social media and on television, of course, it looks like they've done a tremendous job. Both in the arena and with the setup. What was it like on the days you weren't playing? I imagine you probably practiced, but what were you doing to keep busy?
I mean, there was a few things. You know, we had our own viewing area at the arena, so you could always go watch any of the games that were going on. It was kind of cool to be able to see all the other teams playing. There was a golf simulator there, which was pretty cool. I know a lot of the guys like to play golf in the summers, and so that definitely kept us a little bit sane. And I know just a lot of the guys also brought their, you know, Xboxes and PlayStations. So there was a lot of gaming going on in that hotel, but, you know, everyone managed to stay busy, and it was a good time.
You got into a couple of NHL games earlier this season. What was it like kind of being immersed in that bubble, you know, literally and figuratively for a pretty extensive period of time, going through training camp and then up to Edmonton and being there? How do you think that helped you? You didn't get into any games, but how do you think it helped you?
Yeah, I mean, just going through kind of a training camp coming back, I think those are always important for guys. And I think every time I've gone to training camp, I've gotten better. And being able to practice with, you know, the NHL team and being around those guys and seeing how they act as professionals, I think it definitely helped out. Just kind of as I see what I need to do and how I need to, you know, kind of behave to be an NHL player. So it was a good experience. And, you know, I think I definitely got better from it.
You're a Minnesota guy in the Minnesota Wild system with the Wild. I want to ask you about Matt Dumba and what he did, because, of course, everything, you know, happened, you know, a few months ago with George Floyd and everything, of course, in Minnesota. Talk about what Matt did and how inspiring that was for you, your teammates, and everybody in the hockey world, because I know from a personal standpoint, it was very inspiring to see him and his bravery. How did that impact you and your team?
Yeah, you know, he was very open with us, and, you know, he's one of the founders of the Hockey Diversity Alliance. And during camp, we had, you know, lots of meetings about it, and he kind of took us through, you know, ever since that happened, kind of what they've been doing and how they've been trying to, you know, expand the game. You know, I think their slogan is, you know, bring more diversity to hockey. And, you know, I think that's something that's great. And, you know, Matt was, he's very involved and it's something he's very passionate about. And like you said, it took a lot of bravery. I know after it happened, he was, you know, even receiving some, you know, death threats, stuff like that. So, you know, that, it was very serious and, you know, he definitely put his life on the line and, stood for something that really mattered to him and something that needed to change in the world and in hockey culture in general. So he, you know, he definitely had a lot of respect from the teammates and I think it brought, you know, everyone pretty close together.
Yeah, something like that. I mean, it's such a difficult thing, I imagine, for him to do that. And in that setting, the way he did it ahead of the first game, do you think it was, you talk about bringing your team together, but do you think it brought, you know, the NHL and hockey at all levels kind of below that together, even, you know, in a bigger way than what we've seen over the last couple of months?
Yeah, I think definitely. And, you know, you could see after with, you know, Vegas and Dallas Stars when they played with Tyler Seguin and Ryan Reeves and those guys, you know, it's something that a lot of people, a lot of players in the NHL have taken exception to. And, you know, I think it's been nothing but support. And I think it's definitely going to change kind of how, you know, the NHL is and how hockey is perceived. Hopefully, you know, we do kind of bring that diversity into hockey. You know, hockey is for everyone, so hopefully that is really something that continues to grow.
Yeah, there's been a lot of work done and still a long way to go. I want to ask you about a player perspective. You were playing for the most part in the American League this year, and COVID-19 and the pandemic hit and everything shut down. From a player's perspective, what was it like going from a season shutdown to, are we going to play, aren't we going to play, to all of a sudden going into a training camp ahead of an NHL playoff? How did you try and keep active, keep busy, and all that during the downtime at its most severe point?
Yeah, it was hard. When the season shut down, it was very unexpected. And, you know, you didn't know what to think. You didn't know how long, you know, we weren't going to be playing hockey for. We didn't know if we were going to finish the season. And then pretty much from, you know, management down, they told us, you know, just in case anything happens, you got to stay in shape and you got to stay ready. So it was definitely hard. The hockey rinks weren't open. A lot of the gyms weren't open. So a lot of it was, you know, you're doing home workouts, you know, taking the stairs, anything you could really do. But yeah, I think, you know, when I came in into training camp, you know, everyone was in, you know, good shape and everyone was really prepared for this. And I think people didn't really know how it was going to go with the playoff hockey and if guys were going to be ready to play. But I think, you know, it's been very intense and I think guys have been playing great and there's been great games. So it's been really fun to watch.
Have you been watching as the playoffs have gone on, even with Minnesota being eliminated?
Yeah, you know, just being a hockey fan in general, it's been really cool. And being able to see the games over the stretch of the whole day, you know, you don't have to pick between which teams you want to watch, what games you want to watch. You just, you know, wake up in the morning and, you know, hockey's on all day. So it's kind of, you know, a hockey fanatic's dream.
Yeah, I can tell you I've enjoyed it, that's for sure. Talk about the experience of being a part of the Minnesota Wild franchise, because you're a Minnesota kid, as we talked about. So I imagine when you were a young Brennan Menell growing up in Minnesota, the Wild probably prominent in your life, and now you're a part of the organization. Is it pretty surreal?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, growing up, you know, that's all I wanted to do was be a hockey player, and especially for the Wild, you know, it was my favorite team. And you know, I just coming in when I was a free agent and I ended up, you know, signing with them. It was a dream come true. And, you know, I never could have dreamed anything more than playing my first NHL game and in my hometown for hometown team with all my friends and family there. So it's something that I always dreamed of. And, you know, they gave me the opportunity and they believed in me. So I can, you know, I'm forever grateful for that organization for, you know, really being there for me.
Talk about that first NHL game. It's always a big one for anyone that plays in a new league, especially the NHL. What was that like? Were the nerves at an all-time high?
Yeah, you know, I'd be lying if I said I wasn't a little bit nervous. But once I got in the game, you know, any hockey player knows it's just another game, and you're playing how you can play. And you know, I had my teammates there; they were very supportive and, you know, very encouraging. So by the end of the game, I felt super comfortable, and you know, it was something that I had to kind of stop and take a look around and take it in, because it's something that you only get to do once in your life, is play your first game. So I really got to enjoy it, and it's a dream come true.
You got in 5 games with Minnesota this year. Mm-hmm. Does that fuel you even more to, you know, continue to push to become a full-time NHLer on an everyday basis?
Yeah. I think, you know, I got a little bit of a taste of what the lifestyle is like, what it's like to be an NHLer, and how well you get treated. You know, it was something that I, you know, you always wonder if you're good enough. And I felt like when I played, I played well and I felt comfortable. So I know there's things I still need to work on, get better at. So, you know, having a talk with the coaches when I was up, you know, I had a lot of feedback, and now I know what I need to do. And, you know, something that I want to be is a full-time NHLer. So I know I got to keep working, and that little taste just gave me, you know, the motivation even more to, you know, be where I want.
You always have been a point producer at every level. You look at your time with the Vancouver Giants, your year in Lethbridge, even in the American League, points have always been prominent for you, a puck-moving defenseman. Do you feel like Minnesota, you know, is a good spot for you in the sense that you look at Jared Spurgeon, you look at Matt Dumba? I know I asked Kalen Addison this back in January or February when he was traded to Minnesota with Pittsburgh, and he said, I'm ecstatic to be part of the Wild because they've done such a good job over the years of producing, you know, the undersized, smaller defenseman that moves the puck pretty well. And clearly you're right in that category too.
Yeah, I mean, kind of looking at a guy like Jared Spurgeon, you know, he's undersized, and not a lot of people believed in him, I guess you could say. And, you know, I think he's one of the most underrated defensemen in the NHL. And so he's kind of a guy that I've looked up to and tried to emulate in my game. But yeah, it's nice to see that and see that Minnesota really does, you know, they see what he can do. And that's something that I'm just trying to get up to his level. And, you know, he's a really good player. So I think he's going to be in Minnesota for a while, but it gives me something to work for and to look up to.
Talk about the last 3 seasons. You play your year in Lethbridge, and then you get signed by Minnesota, and you've spent the last 3 years in Iowa with the American League team there. What's it like playing hockey in Iowa? Is it a hockey crazy place? And talk about the experience of being a pretty prominent player for them.
Yeah, you know, Des Moines, it's about 3.5 hours outside of where I grew up. You know, I guess Iowa's one of the least populated states in the U.S., but, you know, it's a growing hockey community for sure, and we have some very loyal fans, and, you know, we get a lot of attendance at our games too. So over the 3 years that I've been there, I've just seen it increase, and I think that, you know, it is growing, and I think it will turn into kind of a hockey hotbed, and I think that our team being there, it's really helped out and really helped grow the game. And, you know, it's something that you kind of always want, is to grow the game more. I really like the city. You know, reminds me of my hometown growing up, so I'm very happy to be there.
I want to ask you about your time in the Western Hockey League, and you weren't drafted in the WHL Bantam Draft, just like you weren't drafted in the NHL entry draft. Growing up in Minnesota, what did you know about the WHL? How did you find out about the WHL? I think of some Minnesotans that have played in the Western Hockey League. The first ones that come to mind for me are Ben and Jack Walker from Edina. So how did you learn about the Western Hockey League when you were kind of on that trajectory of potentially playing in this league?
You know, growing up, I didn't know really anything about the Western Hockey League, you know. Minnesota's mostly, you know, you go from high school to Division I, and that's what coaches preach. So it was really, you know, kind of in the dark about what it was all about. I learned that I was listed by Vancouver when I was playing when I was 16, and they talked to me a little bit. So I started to, you know, get some more knowledge, and I started to see, you know, all the players. My ultimate goal was to play in the NHL, and I saw that, you know, WHL is the fast track for the NHL, and they develop so much talent and so many players, and I saw all the guys getting NHL contracts out of there, and for me, it was a leap of faith, and it was something that a lot of people that I knew didn't agree with, losing my NCAA eligibility. But, you know, I very happy with the result. And like you said, I wasn't drafted there. I wasn't drafted in the NHL. But, you know, playing, you know, 72, 76 games a year and playing against, you know, great players and having great coaches and great teammates, it really helped me develop and get to ultimately where I wanted to be.
What do you remember from that first year with the Vancouver Giants? You played 3 years in the league, two with Vancouver, and your final year in Lethbridge. What was it like from a kid from Minnesota to go all the way to, you know, the West Coast and in a big city, Vancouver? What was it like going away from home at 17?
Yeah, it's definitely an adjustment period. Luckily, I had a great family, billet family there, the Weebs. They were awesome, and you know, I had a good friend in Minnesota, David Brum, that came with me, and so that made it a little bit easier. We were both kind of out there together, and but again, we had great guys. I made so many friends, and the city was great. So I got to explore a lot and had lots of fun there. You know, it's one of those things that you look back and I wish I enjoyed it more, because those were, you know, my days in the Western League were the best of my life.
So you play 2 years with Vancouver and then you get traded to Lethbridge. At the time of your trade, you were in Fargo, North Dakota. You get news that you'd been traded and you made that drive. What was that drive like?
It was a lot of thinking. I was excited for the next chapter in my life. I was excited to, you know, I knew when I was traded that Lethbridge was a really good team that came off a really good year, the year before. And, you know, it was a team that 5 years before that, people didn't want to play there, but, you know, they really came in and Pete Anholt and Brent Kissio changed that culture. And now it's one of the best places to play in the Western Hockey League. And anyone that's played there will tell you that. So I was excited to get there and be on a great team and, again, have some great teammates. And, you know, we had a great year, and that was so much fun. And again, those are guys that, you know, I still talk to, and I have great friends from that team.
You had such a tremendous year. You led all Western League defensemen in assists with 59. You had 71 points. How much fun was it? You had 50 points the year before, but it was kind of a big coming out party for you, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was, like I said, we had a great team, and, you know, that was Tyler Wong's final year, and we scored 50 goals, so I know he was, a legend in Lethbridge, and that was just kind of the cherry on top when he scored 50, but, you know, we had a lot of individual success, but that was all because of the team success, and, you know, we made a nice run into playoffs, and I got a lot of experience from that, and like I said, I grew so much as a player. Just from that year, and so it's I think that was definitely the year where I transitioned into a player that I thought I could be, you know, playing at pro hockey.
You mentioned the playoff run. Talk about that run, because it was a deep one, and it was a very intense and emotional playoff series against Red Deer and then Medicine Hat. When you think back to that three-round playoff experience, what comes to mind at the start?
I think, you know, when I first think of that, I think about the first series against Red Deer, and, you know, we were down 3-1 in the series, and, you know, we dug ourselves kind of a little bit of a hole, and we had a lot of injury trouble too. But, you know, we had such a good season. We knew we had great players, and, you know, we came back and we won the next two games, and I knew when we were playing game 7 at home, you know, there was no way we were losing, because the crowd there, it was electric. And I remember that game, and you know, scoring a goal and looking up into the crowd, and it was awesome. So that was that's a memory that I'll always have, and so that's got to be the first thing I think about. And then, you know, the game 7 against Med Hat next round, shorthanded, I was on the ice for that when Wong scored, and that was crazy too. you know, it was looking pretty bleak there. They almost scored right before, and Wong came down, and you know, he was the hero in that series. That was awesome too. And we ran into a really good team against Regina. You know, they had some great players like Sam Steele and Adam Brooks. So we fought hard though, six games, and you know, it's I'll remember it for the rest of my life. It was a great year.
You actually scored two goals in that game seven against Red Deer, if you forgot.
Yeah.
I want to ask you about the winner in overtime, because we had Jordy Bellaraven. We've had Tyler Wong on Saturday sit down. We had Jordy about a month ago, and he made mention. He said, you know, Wonger had the puck, and I was there. I kind of gave him a tough time. Tyler said this, and you were there too. What do you remember from that goal? And then, of course, the euphoria at the end of it.
You know, I just remember, yeah, we were on the PK, and Skinner made a huge save right before. You know, I think any other goal or any other goalie would have let that in, but he had a great save, and we just came back down, and I think we had a 3-on-2, and I remember he just had the puck, and they had a forward playing defense, so he attacked him, and I just kind of watched it. He shot right through him, and it went, you know, top corner. It was a beautiful shot, and just the feeling of scoring a game seven overtime winner. Everyone skated across the ice, and the bench cleared out, and huge hugs, and it was, you know, it's a feeling unlike anything else.
You get the sense, just hearing you talk, that you know you think fondly of your time in Lethbridge, and you always hear of guys who go on and play in the National Hockey League and have a long professional career, and they always say, one of my best times was playing junior. Do you feel like that 3 years out, that, you know, playing junior hockey, playing in Lethbridge with the Hurricanes, that playoff run is always going to kind of, I don't want to say take the cake in everything that you'll accomplish, because hopefully there's a lot more that you will accomplish in hockey, but do you think it's something that'll always kind of be at the forefront of your hockey career, you know, 20 years down the line when you look back?
Yeah. You know, I think a big difference between, you know, junior hockey and pro hockey is that when you're in junior hockey, you know, you're very close with your teammates, you know, you're all the same age, you're all in it together. And, you know, once you get to pro hockey, guys have families and, you know, kids. So not everyone's as close, but, you know, you're kind of, an innocent teenager. And you know, you just have your buddies, and you're playing for each other out there. You know, you're not worried about points, you're not worried about making money, you're worried about, you know, playing. And so when I think back to, you know, my years of playing junior hockey, that's what I think of, is just how excited I was to be playing and playing with my friends. And like you said, I think anyone that played junior hockey could say those would be the best memories.
I think we can leave it there. Such a great time getting to reconnect and chat and go down memory lane. And here's to hoping we'll see Brennan Menell in a Minnesota Wild jersey on a full-time basis starting next year. Brennan, thanks so much for this.
Yeah, thank you, Forbesy.
All right, there's Brennan Menell from the Hockey State on another edition of Saturday Sit Down. We hope you enjoyed it.